I'm talking to you about turning your dreams into destiny.
The only thing you have to know about him is he moves a lot.
Yeah.
And it's interesting, we're talking about Joseph, this dreamer. We've had some dreamers in our time. And one in particular on the 50th anniversary of Mayor Evers, who was a civil rights activist, secretary, first statewide secretary of the NAACP, responsible for voters registration, boycotts, and in particular investigations for crimes against Afro-Americans, was murdered on June 12, 1963. Not just murdered, but assassinated in front of his house because he dared to dream in Jackson, Mississippi. Let's take a moment of silence and just remember hard work that provided opportunities for you and I this very day.
Amen.
We thank the Evers family, we thank the NAACP for all the work that they're doing, and particularly we thank Michelle, who's here from the NAACP here. She'll raise her hand. Happy to have her here.
Amen.
Amen. Pray, let me say thank you for your work. Mother Evers, we thank her. We also have a special guest with, all the special guests. You're all special guests. If I say special guests, what am I? All special guests. But we see Desiree, we have your
mom.
Mom. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We hope, trust, and pray to Michelle and to Mom that you enjoy the services here and that something said from the Word of God that will cause you to seek Him more here at Uptown Church of Christ. We're a growing church, we're a striving church, we're a maturing church, and we certainly open our hearts and what we have up to you. And we'd love an opportunity to study with you. Everybody have your Bibles this morning?
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. If you hold your Bibles up high, make sure we have our Bibles. I want you to follow along with me as we go through the Word of God, the engrafted Word of God, which is able to build our souls. Put it on your calendar Thursday night to come and support discussion or debate. Is baptism essential? Pastor Reverend, he calls himself, Michael Parker. I'm Brother Hamilton. We will certainly be addressing that through the Word of God. Let's look at Genesis 37 and verse number 5. And we see that having dreams, as Nagar had, as Martin Luther King had, is not a new thing to the Bible. The Bible says that Joseph dreamt the dream. I suggest that any man that fails a dream fails in his life. Every person here ought to want to have something and ought to have a desire to be somebody.
Amen.
If you're having dreams or you're having thoughts or lack of desire is problematic, then something's wrong. If you allow life to take away your thought about who you are and where God wants you and how God wants things to develop in your life, it's not because God does not allow it. It's because you're not allowing it to work in your mind. But the text says that he had a dream and he made a fatal mistake. See, for dreamers this morning, dreamers need to know, and those that I can put it differently to that understand it better, for folk who have aspirations in life to seek the will of God, you have to be careful who you tell yourself to.
Amen.
I had learned that you can't tell everybody everything. And God showed you something everybody can't handle. What God is showing you. As a matter of fact, it goes against the psychological profile of people to want to see you do better than what they're doing. After all, Joseph had already received the birthright in their mind out of order, but according to God's divine will. And here he was, now this 17-year-old male had the illuminating gall to look at them and say, guess what? Look what God showed me. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be around anybody that don't have some dreams in life. Some aspirations in life. And the three things we need to get from this text. Number one, God will often show you something, but not tell you the design of your destiny. And the reason he doesn't tell you the design of your destiny, because if you can see it, you wouldn't do it. Amen. If you can see it, you can pray to God right now, God, I want a husband to love me, a spiritual man. And God may respond and say, I'm going to send him. I'm going to send him, but I can't tell you how he's going to get it. And you don't know it's going to take 10 evil men to help you appreciate a good man. Because if you can see it was going to take 10 evil men, you wouldn't want the good man. Because it'd be too much to go through. Y'all say, I'll be with you just a moment. And so God shows Joseph something. But he does not show Joseph the stuff he's going to go through to get through his, get to his destiny. And so he dreams a dream, and because he doesn't see what God sees, he goes to what becomes a temporary enemy, but used by God, and said, I dreamed a dream, and we were out in the field. I'm in the next verse. We were out in the field, and we were bending sheaves, and my shaft stood up and arose, and you were out there also, and your shaft stood and made abstinence to me. It bowed down to me. And the Bible says his brothers hated him for what God had shown him. Sometimes in your greatness, you need to learn to be humble, because folk can't take this. You're going to be the crab that get out of the bucket. I'm going to say amen. When you got that promotion, everybody what happened is you got that promotion. Some folk roll their eyes. Some people couldn't sleep at night. Some people fuss at God and say, God, how could you give it to her, not me? I'm better than her. But everybody's not happy for you because God's getting ready to do something in your life. You need to understand, when you have an aspiration for something, sometimes it needs to be just between you and God. Amen. And so God does not show him the prince. He does not show him the piss. And he does not show him the prison for him to get there. And we are left in the opening text to visualize Joseph at age 17 talking like he got it going on. Amen. Say amen if you will. And the response is pretty much the same response we get today. Now here's the importance of this. Watch what God does. God does not immediately bless Joseph with what he showed him. He did not bless him. He did not immediately bless him. But God showed him, and he had aspirations and believed what he had seen in his spirit, urged by God, that it would happen. And God doesn't show him, young man, because if he see it, he can't believe it. And I want you to know right now, that's some stuff. If God were to show you, you're going to go through in through the rest of 2013, you wouldn't want to go through 2013, because you're not going to understand how in the world I'm going to go through all that stuff and get to where God's trying to take you. But in order to get to your destiny, you got to go through your trials. In order to go through your trials, you have to have faith to move toward your trials. Y'all all right? And so that's, I need to do this very quick, and I get into the lesson. How old is Joseph in the text?
17.
He's 17 years of age. From 17, he is put into a pit. The next day or so, he is moved from the pit into slavery. And from slavery into prison, because he was accused of raping Potiphar's wife. 17 years had passed by. What's 17 plus 13?
30.
Somebody said 30. 30 is the number of the free spirit of God to begin a ministry. God has every intention of doing things symbolically that will support what you've seen if you'll just look for what God is doing. God didn't do it at age 20. He didn't do it at age 25, but he did it at age 30. Well, how do you know that's a symbolic number for a free spirit or the freeing of you to operate in your ministry? Well, Jesus started his ministry when? At age 30. John Baptist started his ministry when? At age 30. David started his ministry when? At age 30. Guess what? Joseph started his ministry. He had a green light at age what? 30 years of age. Now watch this. Watch God's word. Watch God's word now. Because see, the problem with some of you is that you look at numbers and things, just think there's something you miss. God giving you signs that keep going in the right direction. God is a God of equity. God is a God of equality. God begins his ministry at 30, but he reigned for 80 years. I often wonder why 80 years? Well, 40 is the number for tribulation. God gave him a Job blessing. He said, you went through this stuff, this tribulation, because of your faith in me. And you even did right when you made it to your destination. So you will reign twice the time of your tribulation. Instead of 40 years of celebration, I'm going to give you a double blessing, and you'll reign 80 years in your celebration. I don't know about you, but I'm glad God is a God that gives us double for our trouble. You don't understand, amen. 80 years should not be easily overlooked. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that whatever you're going through, God is going to bless you twice as much in what you're going through right now. But you got to do like old Joseph. Joseph was a man of faith. Joseph was a man who moved according to the Spirit of God, regardless of what he went through. Joseph was one who realized that I serve a good God and a great God, able to finish that which he has put before me. And you got to believe right now, no matter how hard times get, God is able. The Bible says that Joseph is not the first person who sojourned and traveled. You remember in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, verses 9 and 10, if I'm not mistaken, the Bible says that by faith, he sojourned. Sojourned means that he faith walked. What you mean he faith walked? He sojourned and traveled in the promised land. Hold on, I'm in the land that God promised me, but I don't know where I'm going. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going to walk by faith. And I'm going to leave because the Spirit is urging me to leave. Y'all not with me right now. Some of you have got to your destiny because you don't move. You don't move unless you see something. And sometimes you don't get to your destiny because you don't move because of what you see. And because it looks hard. When we began this work, 4 years ago and walked in, there were about 8 people sitting there. I could easily say this is not going to work. And even as we've come collectively together, if I looked out and I looked at all the things that are glaring at me and I was not a man of faith, I would throw my hands up and say, forget it. We might as well pack it up and go home. But I'm a dreamer and God says it's able. I believe he's able. You might get mad. You know, folk get mad when you start talking about building another. How are we going to build a church? We can't even get this one. We got to take him care of. How we go? You just chose some brothers. Am I right about it? I should have kept my mouth shut when I said we're going to get a building. But I tell you, let me tell you something else about us, about Joseph brothers. Here's the thing that messed them up with Joseph brothers. Folk are not going to help you have more than what they have. Amen. You can't tell nobody, my sheep stood up. And yours stood round about and made obstinance to me. And I want you to help me with that. You can't tell folk, church, we're going to build a church. And in this church, we're going to have a counseling center in the church. And I'm going to work at the church to help folk with challenges that they have and a means that they can afford to get psychological help that they need. And church, we're going to have a secretary. We're going to have folk that employ at the church. And all we're going to do is ministry. And Brother Henry, what you going to do? Well, I'll be here at the church doing church work. Well, you need to get a job. That is my job. Well, I tell you what, if you do it, it won't be by one green dollar of mine. You're not going to sit up in this church and in the air condition while I'm out here working. Now, your sheep not going to never sin. If you need me to help your sheep stand, somebody pick up it. Y'all all right? Now, y'all know this. That was part of the boy's problems. But church, you have to keep moving toward what God is showing you in your spirit. Am I right about it? And when you move to what God is showing you, you're not going to like what you see. You're not going to like what you feel. You're not going to like what you're going through. But if you really have faith in God, that God is able, you'll go through whatever you got to go through to get what God has for you in your life. And the only person that can hear me right now are folks who have aspirations for the will of God in their life. You're not hearing this lesson right now if you don't have aspirations. What does God, what would God have me to do? God does not make mistakes. When God blesses us, He promotes us, He progresses us, and He procures our blessings. He takes care of everything we need, but we're not going to like the journey that we have to go through to get there. Y'all all right? Y'all all right? Some people call me sometimes, I'm going through this, I'm going through that. I said, it may be part of the process. Am I right about it? Look at Paul. Paul was one who moved by the Spirit of God. In Acts chapter 20, I saw around the 25th verse, he said, now listen, I'm going bound in the Spirit. Say amen when you get there. I'll wait on you. Say amen when you get there. I don't want to go too fast. I need to learn how to slow down. Say amen when you get there. All right. You're in Acts 20, 22 through 24. I want you to watch this. Because you sit up and saying, God bless you with this. God bless you with that. God bless me. God said, okay, I'm going to bless you. But I'm not going to tell you how I'm going to bless you. Look at my neighbor and say, he ain't going to tell me. And he ain't going to tell you. And when you get through praying, it ain't gonna look like he's blessing you. Are y'all listening to me? When the preacher finished praying, stuff's gonna look just like it was when God prayed. When you go home, it's gonna look just like it looked. Because it's not about the prayer. It's about the faith you have in prayer. In what God is showing you. James chapter 1 about the celebration said, when a man asks something, let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering. If you look at your bank account to solve your problem and you're working 15 jobs, you just spinning your wheels. You have to soldier and travel, have faith in God that God can do what God says He can do. Now watch this. Watch Paul. You know Paul been through some stuff. He was destined from his mother's womb to be a chosen vessel for God. If he's learned one thing, he's learned he can trust God. He says, and now I'm going. I go bound in the Spirit. What is bound in the Spirit? Something's moving me that I don't know what it is, but something in my spirit is urging me to move in a direction, and I'm going to be faithful to the Spirit, and I don't know what's going to befall me because there have been times that I have been stoned almost to death. Acts 14 and 22. There have been times that I've been shipwrecked on my journeys. Y'all can relate to Paul here. Yeah. There have been times false brethren have talked about me and hurt me and delivered me to the enemy. There have been times I've been incarcerated trying to do the wills of God. There have been times I've been lied on trying to do the will of God. There are times people have laughed at me because of my calamity doing the will of God. What's out there, but something's moving me. Church, this morning, I want to ask you something. Is the Spirit of God moving you? If it's moving you, you need to go where God sent, despite not knowing what's out there. You're not going to know what's out there. He said, I go pound in the Spirit, and I don't know what things shall befall me there. Next verse. Watch this. He said, let me tell you something. Save the Holy Ghost. What you're saying, Joseph might not have known what was in front of you, but God knows what's in front of you. And as long as God knows, Brother Henry, Brother Evans, Brother Evans, Sister Fountain, as long as God knows what's in front of you, the in the master's hand. And you're the prophet, you're trying to know what God knows. And you need to stop knowing what God knows. God told you what you're going to do. God said, you want to be great, a great people for me and bring forth the Christ. Don't worry about how you get to your destiny. God knows the journey. He said, but the Holy Ghost knows. And then listen to what he says. He said, the Holy Ghost knows that my conflicts, my trials are really inside of me. Well, I had to stop right there when I read that in this lesson of the years. Because what he was saying is that it's not that God can't deliver you to your destiny or turn your dreams into destiny. Is do you have the faith to maintain the course in the midst of your conflict? And if you have the faith, the conflict that's inside of you and the affliction that's inside of you is you wrestling with whether or not to stay the course. How many times have you been right before something you can reach out and touch it and just quit right in front of you? Because it got rough, it got hard, just turn around and say, I can't do this, I can't make it, it's too hard, I can't take it no more. The coming out that God can't do it. The problem, can you go through the pits and the pain and the prison and all to get to the pillar? Because if you get through that, the conflict is not going to come in. It's can you handle it? Can you go through trials and tribulations and still remain faithful in God? Because if you can't handle it, you can't handle it. You don't allow me to run you from the church. That's your problem. That ain't my problem. God allowed you as a free moral agent to make your decision. You prayed for salvation. You prayed for deliverance for your family. You prayed for joy, hope, and peace. And whatever comes your way, you ought to stay on course and run this race, not in vain. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor's not in vain. I don't care what you're going through. All I know is what God showed me. Brother, help me, won't you just quit? These folk ain't going to do nothing. But as far as I know, God says it's going to be a great church one day. Well, some people left. That's all right. As far as I know, God said we're going to be a great church and sit on a hill that cannot. I shall not quit relent. I don't care about myself, but God has shown me something that I dreamt about. I believe God can do it. I believe he can do it. I believe he can do it. You know something I learned in all this process? I learned that folk not going to be excited for your dream. It's not their dream. Amen. There's a reason why you meet everybody in the church. They didn't see what you see. Amen. Y'all can be funny. You trying to ask somebody to be excited. If your wedding ain't my wedding, I ain't married to you, married. Man, you know what? I just pulled a biblical fox. Man, don't you have it for me? Yeah. I ain't getting biblical fox. Y'all know what I'm saying? Come on, man. And that's why the preacher always seems like he's so holy and all this kind of stuff. Because God touched his heart and showed him something. You hadn't seen that. And so you don't have the same tenacity or the spirit. But if you just trust in the Lord, if you just trust in the Lord, and if God stays with him, you'll get to your corn just like his mama, his daddy, and everybody. He ain't everybody else ain't because he ain't. But we have to have faith in God. Amen. We have to have faith in God. Y'all all right? We gotta stop acting like Joseph, brother. The Bible says that they envied him the more. You know, the more folk came. You remember over in 1 Samuel 16, around the 8th verse, when David went out and conquered Goliath and came back, and everybody was saying, you know, man, David got his, Saul has his 1,000, David has his 10,000. The Bible said from that point, Saul eyed him, and he envied him from that point on. Don't you know, as God began to move in this church, starts to grow, the audience starts to get feel, some folks are going to start rolling their eyes when I get up to preach it. But you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to say, God showed it to me. God showed it to me. Don't you know, when you bought your new car, some folks were slamming their doors when they got home. But you got to say, you know what? God showed it to me. All right. You know, whatever that promotion, they said you weren't smart enough, you weren't bright enough, but you sit there in the office eating popcorn, telling your secretary, get in here right now. But you ain't never said that to nobody before, and it just feels good to say that. And when she come in, you don't even know what to tell her to do, but it sure feels good to say, get in here right now. I just want to say it, but get in here right now. But when they look, they say, God showed it to me. God showed it to me. God gave it to me. I went through hell to get here, but God gave it to me. How many believe God's trying to do something in your life right now? How many believe God's trying to do something in your life? Now watch this. He If you believe he's showing you something, nobody can take that from you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how much they envy you, how much they talk about your past mistakes, how much they talk about, you know, Joseph's line was a mess. That's how he ended up with the birthright in the first place. I don't care how much they talk about your past, your family. You made this. Jesus' bloodline is not the perfect bloodline.
Amen.
There are whores in Jesus' bloodline. They're the bad folk in Jesus' bloodline. Folk who turned from God, Solomon who betrayed God, but is still cleaned up by the blood of Christ. God used every last one of them. If God shows you something, he does not necessarily give you direction of how you're going to turn your dreams into your destiny. And what you need to stop doing is stop messing up the plan by getting out of the master's hand. You need to be faithful to what God has shown you. And if God has shown you and said, listen, I place you here to worship God, to worship me, I put you in this position because I'm about to open some doors for your family. I've done that for you, but there are going to be some conflicts within you that you're going to have to pass the test in order to get the victory. You ought to say amen and yes, Lord. Well, why don't Joseph